What is up, Mile Higher homies?
Welcome back to the Mile Higher podcast, hosted by the Kendall Ray and the Joshua Dore. Hey, you never know. We got some new viewers or new listeners to the podcast these days. So,
cool.
We got to make sure people know who we are, because sometimes when you go to a new podcast, you don't necessarily start with episode one, because I didn't specify our podcast on iTunes as being one that you have to start from one and go through. It doesn't need to be chronological. So I'm just saying, maybe people want to know who the fuck we are.
Okay. But, well, hi. How you doing?
How you doing? But welcome back, guys. We are here for another episode of the Mile Higher podcast, where we take things
a mile higher
every episode. But welcome back. Today we have a very... I think it's going to be a very interesting and really just crazy episode about the Golden State. I almost said the Golden State Warriors.
No. Okay. I knew that was going to happen before I even started this. I was like, someone is going to say Golden State Warriors. The Golden State Killer.
Yes.
Okay. So this is a serial killer that has been on the loose for a long time. And we're going to tell you all about it, obviously.
Yes.
But there was a huge development in this week. And I think a lot of you probably heard about it because so many of you have tweeted me like, hey, can you talk about what actually happened with this whole case? Because now that there's all this breaking news, people want to know what's going on. Like, who is this? I've never heard of it. So we're going to break it down for you and go over, like, isn't it like 30 years worth of stuff?
No, it's 10 years of actual activity. But yeah, years. It's been years since we've seen him.
Since the beginning, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, we'll be jumping into that. But before we jump into that, I have some news for those out there that haven't been on the Twitch streams with us lately. But yeah, guys, so a lot of you know that I took a break from my channel, and I wasn't sure if I was going to come back and do YouTube videos anymore. But over the past couple weeks, I feel like I've had a lot of time to really think about things and think about what I want for my future and what do I want to be doing. Especially when it comes to all of this type of stuff. And I gotta say, like, I think what did it for me is that the Twitch streams have been absolutely just a blast and just so much fun. So thank all of you guys that have come over to Twitch, you know, especially those of you that, you know, never were on Twitch before. We really appreciate it. And it's just been a lot of fun, because I think what a lot of people are noticing is that it's literally like a virtual hangout. It's like we are... Like, literally, you know, together, except we're not. We're there
because it's such
virtually.
A small group on there right now. Twitch is like such a smaller platform than YouTube, so you can, like, you know, we have like really intense conversations with people. It's really fun. Like, shout out to all the people on the
shout out to my mom, Leo.
Oh yeah.
No, it's a lot of fun though, and a lot of people have hopped on there and like, oh my god, I didn't know I could, you know, get to know you like this, because I mean, it's literally, you know, about the most real version of me you're gonna get, I think.
Yeah.
So no, it's just been a lot of fun, and I think what I needed to realize about doing all of this is, you know, what I want to feel like energized and feel like I have a purpose, you know, in all of this.
Yeah.
And I found that purpose when I got to interact with you guys. That's what I was missing, was that like interaction with your audience. I just wasn't getting it before, and I wasn't doing it on YouTube before. So I think I just got kind of like burnt out real quick.
No, dude, here's what happened. Since I started and no one knew who I was, and I didn't have like any way to promote my channel, I like appreciated every single subscriber, and I got to know them. I knew their usernames. Like, I still remember my first subscriber, her username was like Cutie Cat Noob or something. And I've to this day wondered like where
That's
she
awesome.
Is. Like,
yeah.
So I understand that, because now on Twitch you're building up an audience like slowly over time, and you're getting to know them. Like, it's just a whole different thing, because my audience means something to me on like a deep level, because I've earned them.
They've been riding with you for
years.
Yeah,
and I appreciate them so
much.
Right,
totally.
So
yeah, and I think that's the thing, because when I put up my first video on YouTube, I already had like over 10,000 subscribers. You know, just because you guys wanted to come support me. And
they had seen you on Trippy Talks and stuff. So you had already kind of...
You got a taste of the Joshua Dore.
Yeah.
You didn't get the full experience. But anyways, to make a long story short, I have decided to return to YouTube and make a video every week, one video a week on Wednesdays, which will now be known as Woke Wednesdays.
Yes.
So awesome. I'm excited. Yeah, I'll be back this coming Wednesday with a new video on my channel, Josh Adore, on YouTube. And
sick.
I'm really pumped. I just feel energized. I think I'm ready to bring some really good stuff. And I hopefully will be a lot more natural on camera because I feel like Twitch has helped me get over that hurdle completely. Like,
yeah.
I don't even think about the camera anymore because that's like a big thing for a lot of people when you start doing this is like getting used to sitting in front of this camera and not feeling weird or awkward or, you know, you just get that nervous feeling and stuff, you know, you kind of just get like kind of tense up because you're like,
I'm on camera. And it's weird in the beginning. Like, I remember thinking it was weird to see myself on camera all the time or even see myself in the viewfinder tripped me out. And the sound of my voice drove me insane forever. And now I'm finally used to it. But your voice sounds like way different than you hear it in your own head. So, like,
oh, absolutely.
It's really weird.
It's crazy.
It's really weird. So,
I'm pumped to be back. And I hope all of you are too, because, you know, this is just the beginning. This is just the beginning of the podcast, because the other good news we got this week, which a lot of you noticed yesterday, it's kind of a funny story now, especially with the developing events today, but we finally got monetized on YouTube this week, which was great news.
Took 16 weeks though, my friends.
Yeah, it took a while.
God, it's insane.
But yeah, they finally monetized us. So, you know, you're seeing ads now, which is great. So yeah, no, we're happy about that. And, you know, obviously, you know, thank you guys for all the support during this time.
But
it's been now that we're, you know, monetizing stuff, we're like good to like go full steam ahead, you know, plow through all the shit and find the truth. So that's what we're doing.
Yeah. And talk about the topics we've been like saving.
But what happened today?
So today we get this email from YouTube and it said, well, first of all, earlier today, I got an email from YouTube on my vlog channel, which has like 50,000 subscribers. It's like a small little thing I do. And one of my vlogs from like a couple months ago got not only flagged, but removed completely. And I got a strike on my channel for using drugs.
Community guidelines strike.
For using drugs because I showed the Cloud 9 syrups, which are 100% natural,
legal.
Completely legal in all 50 states, CBD. Like it's like tea. Pretty much.
It's
like,
the same fucking thing herb. As going to the
hemp
store
hemp.
And buying green tea or extract or something. It's the same thing,
it's
guys.
It's the same
it's a
thing.
Plant. It's a fucking plant.
It's so ridiculous. So I got that. And then not only that, I can't even get my video back now. Like, it's gone.
They
and
deleted
I don't have it.
They deleted
backed up. So I don't even remember what happened in that vlog, but I lost
damn,
it.
Damn, that's shitty.
I lost those memories completely, which sucks.
See, that's...
It makes me scared about
I don't understand
the
why
fact
they do
that we don't
that.
Back up our stuff. Cause we can't because we put so much out there. It's just too much.
They should give you an option to download your footage.
Yeah, and have it all stored.
I should tweet that at them.
Yeah,
they
seriously.
Should do that. That's like, if you're going to remove the video completely from the platform and just straight up delete it.
Why can't you just make it
give
private?
Me a, yeah. Private it and don't let you make it go public.
I was like, what the hell?
What's the difference? Why does that have to be like deleted? Like, it's
so
like
dumb.
Harsh ban hammer, bam, and you're done.
And I'm assuming this is a mistake because this is not a drug.
No.
It's not an illegal drug. I'm not promoting drugs. Like, how ridiculous. So
it's just, you
I
know what it is?
The system's, you know, falsely flagging me. Josh thinks it could even be monks. Talking about monks.
Yes. The AI is just...
detecting stuff that just, we say
it
do.
Needs to be fine-tuned to understand the difference between
smoking
CBD and THC. Somebody needs to program that shit into your fucking robot.
So then, like an hour later, Josh gets an email and it's like, your podcast has been
episode
removed.
15 Unexplained Phenomena Part 1 has been fucking removed from YouTube
completely. Like, they deleted it and we can't even like restore it. So
luckily I did save the project file, so I'm re-exporting it now. And as soon as...
it'll be re-uploaded.
I mean, either way, guys, like... I mean, if they just straight up, like, deny my appeal, like... So you're able to appeal these strikes.
I think it will probably
I hope
be
it will, because I literally was like, this is a mistake. We are not, like, showing drugs or something. Because, dude, the appeal is one line of text. You can't even type like a couple sentences. It's like literally a sentence and a half, and then you have to hit okay. It's like, what am I supposed to say? Fucking mistake. Undo. That's what I should have put. Undo.
undo.
Damn you, YouTube. No.
No, it's just so, it's really annoying. So I don't know. I'm really trying to have faith in YouTube because I have seen some very, very good improvements this year. I have to say they've made some improvements and I think this is an error. I don't think they purposely did this. And I don't want to like come across like I'm defending YouTube because I'm fucking pissed. My career has been like a fucking roller coaster forever because of them. But they've improved their communication so much from when I started. It's insane. Like you couldn't even at all talk to someone unless you had at least a couple of million subscribers or something. Like PewDiePie could barely get people on the phone, I remember. And now they're communicating. Like I have a chat, I have an email. So I know they're making these like little steps and they're trying to improve the software as well.
Which is great.
It's great.
But my big butt is here.
My big butt.
God, I just realized I set that up for myself.
Here. Okay, all right. Is your butt here or not?
It's here. It arrived. All right. So, but YouTube, here's a little advice from a former tech person and former tech employee.
Yeah.
Whenever you roll out new features, please fucking beta test that shit or like roll it out to some test users before you just like give it to the masses. I mean, unless I'm in the beta test group and I don't fucking know, but seriously though, like you should roll that, like test it and see how it goes and works before you just make it the thing. And then I lose valuable content with no forewarning at all. Like no, it's just gone. You got 7 days to watch it and then appeal and it's done.
That's crazy.
I'm like, what the fuck?
It's gone.
Seriously.
Bye, bitch.
And then no, it's like appeal guys, it and you is, type honestly, like one sentence.
It is
like,
crazy that this bad. Happened today. Like I'm honestly pretty mind blown because I've been on YouTube for 6 years now, almost 6 years, right? Let's see.
Is
2012 I started. So yeah, I'm going on 6 years. Wow, that's a long time. I feel old now. But what was I just saying? Damn.
Your career, how long your career's been? You've been on YouTube for 6 years.
What was I going
to
say about
it? You were trying to explain.
Guys, this is real life.
Yeah, you were trying to explain when you started to now. I think I asked you what the dates were or something. Maybe not.
Oh my gosh. I'm going to.
Doesn't matter.
This happens to me so much. It's
brain
insane.
Fog.
I walk into rooms and completely forget why I'm there like all the time.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Damn. I had like a great thing to say. Well, I'll let you know if it comes to me.
Moving but on. No, I mean, it hasn't been smooth sailing for sure. And anybody that makes YouTube videos knows that. And
yeah,
you know, I think they're, you know, due to these unfortunate events that have unfolded for them, I think they've been kind of like kicked in the ass to get it going.
Yeah.
And so they're trying to ramp up and they're trying to ramp up ASAP because if they don't, then profits are lost, you know,
they lose ad money. It makes total sense. And like, that's why I'm trying to be like understanding.
Ultimately,
I just want to see progress. Like, I think they understand that YouTube, we are the backbone of your platform. If you treat us like shit or treat us unfairly and censor us, like, I understand reasonable rules, though. Like, there's some of my videos that get flagged. I'm like, all right, fair enough. That was pretty fucking graphic.
Yeah, yeah, you know? I get
like,
it. Yeah.
I get it. Like, rapes and stuff.
No,
like,
the
I don't,
review
I understand.
Process has been decent. Like, I think it's been pretty good.
Yeah.
I mean, I feel like they could improve providing more detail about why they, you know, made the choice they did initially. But it's gotten better. So, hopefully things
like,
keep moving
like
in the right direction.
I like YouTube in a way because what I was trying to say earlier is I've been on it for so long that like I love YouTube's like such a part of me and like it almost hurts me when like people talk shit about it, even though I like am so angry with them. But it's just like annoys me to my core that they haven't, you know, that at one point it felt like they really were like working against us. So I'm trying to be peaceful about it, manifest good things and really, really hope that they're going to, you know, start listening and really make some good changes.
I think they are.
Because, you know, come on, you guys. Marijuana is legalized in like multiple states and we still can't like CBD is legal everywhere. It's like very well known. Get with the times. It's ridiculous.
You know what it is? It's just they need to do some more tuning with the AI because the AI is making mistakes. So it's fine. Whatever. I mean, they'll get through it hopefully and hopefully sooner than later. It has been rapid progression. It seemed like. From where we were like a year or two ago when it was like adpocalypse time, like, and we thought YouTube was ending, you know?
Yeah.
So I think we just have to remember that it's gotten a lot better since then.
It's gotten so much better. And I'm grateful because I was so scared last April, I had a video make $11.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, I was like, I'm going to have to quit this. And it's crazy. Like, you know, things have gotten a lot better since then. It's still not like to where it should be.
No, it's not at an optimal level.
The improvement's getting there. And yeah, so I feel more secure. But we have been talking for 15 minutes. so we did that because we are skipping we don't have any sponsors yet, but all affiliate, all product stuff. And we're jumping right into the content right now.
Yes, but before that,
the Stella Patreon.
We have to thank our supporters on Patreon. Appreciate it, guys. Especially our stellar patrons. And we've got Jocelyn B. I hope that I'm pronouncing that right. But Jocelyn. Elizabeth B., Rebecca H., and a new one, Selena M. So thank you guys so much for being stellar patrons and all of our other patrons for supporting us. And I know some of you are waiting on some stuff, and we will get that stuff to you very soon. Don't you worry. So thank you guys so much. And our Patreon question of the week comes from Shay. And she said, hey guys, in terms of reincarnation and past lives, do you think that you've met one another in a past life? Hmm. And or how do you think time behaves? Does it bend? Is it linear? Or is it just all coexisting at once?
This is like a really intense question.
Yes. Yes.
Perhaps in a metaphoric bowl coexisting all at once. Dude, Shay, you are deep.
That was a great question.
That is. It was like really well written too. Metaphoric bowl. I really like that.
I think it's possible. I think it's very possible because I do feel a very deep connection with you.
I felt like when I first met you that I had like known you before, like I had seen you. I always have this covering my face. Sorry. I don't know. I kind of just like felt like very like connected to you. I don't know, but like sometimes I'm like, is that just like my mind like making it like better than it was?
Well, that's the thing. You but always like, have I, that doubt I, that's like, well, maybe I'm just.
But there was a lot of guys that like I met and they didn't make like an impression on me like you did.
Impression.
Seriously, like I knew who you were on my Facebook. I had a lot of guys on my Facebook.
I know.
I
you
knew
did.
Who you were. There was a lot of that I just didn't know, but I always like knew who you were.
You know,
and like
kept
up
wizard,
with what you
man.
Were doing for like 2 years.
Who's the woke wizard?
Like I want that woke
Josh
wizard.
Dors.
Okay, all right, we need to get going here.
No, but let me answer her question. I think that it's possible. Do I know for sure? No.
Mm-hmm.
But I do, like I said, feel a connection to you, and I definitely felt that, you know, even before I met you, just from like texting, and you just feel like we were just so on the same page from day one. Let's just say that. Almost
like
the same person. Sometimes we joke like you're the female version of me. It's very interesting because we're very, very similar.
Our
with
birth
each other.
Charts are so similar. Like, it's crazy.
Yeah.
Our
so astrology. There's definitely astrological alignment there, which, you know, makes me think that
could be twin flames, even.
Everything is bending.
Which is where
time
you like share
bending.
A soul.
It's all coexisting at once.
Time behaves. Does it bend? Is it linear? I don't know. That it's like trips me out because I'm like, of course it's linear because here I am and time is moving forward.
Right.
Like, I'm watching the clock right now, it's going forward.
Right, but that's linear and just in the sense of what you perceive
I know,
reality
exactly.
to be.
That's why it's like, hard to like even
probably know
think
it could be like
it.
Waves of just
like what is
just swirling everywhere. Yeah, I mean
that's what I ask myself every day I get up and I'm like, what the fuck is all this? What is it? Where did
welcome
I get,
back to the
how
simulation.
How did I get here?
Resume game.
Sometimes I like to pretend I'm a sim. Does anyone else do that?
That's so funny because like that's like by far the most highly talked about topic on my Twitch channel
is
talking about the simulation theory and just like whether because especially when we play you know certain games it's like feels like you're literally in the simulation.
Yep.
So maybe
we love to play
maybe
Sims.
We're just simulated.
We have a baby on Sims called Elon Woke.
Elon Woke.
Okay. Well, that was a great question.
Yes, great question. Thank you, Shay. So first order of business is this kind of, I think, flew under the radar a little bit, I think, because I had to dig a little bit to find it. But this week, Trump delayed the release of the JFK assassination files. So last year, President Trump vowed to release all of the longtime secret files related to the JFK assassination.
Mm-hmm.
And the administration announced on Thursday that some of the documents will actually now be withheld until October 2021.
Here's why.
For national security reasons.
Here's why. Because Daddy Bush hasn't died yet.
waiting for Mr. Bushy to die.
Yeah, that's definitely what's going on. I know
it's fucked, but it's
the truth. They are waiting for George Bush Sr. to die because his name is... That's what they're withholding, is names. And they have already found his name in JFK documents. And they were like, oh no, that was a different George Bush. That was also in the... they seriously said that. They tried to pull that off and act like he was involved in it. Like, dude, come on. You were working in the CIA. So he was definitely in there. I think that's what it is. They just have to wait. They're like, God, he's really hanging on. His wife died like last week.
Yeah. Yeah. Apparently in a White House memo, Trump said that the nation's intelligence community persuaded him to keep some of the documents secret because their exposure could harm, quote, identifiable national security, law enforcement, and foreign affairs concerns. Mm-hmm. Who do we know that was in the CIA?
And they could also be worried about if there's something sketchy going on, right, another country figuring it out, putting it together and using it as a weapon again, like for, like, that's joining true. Up with
it
people
could be something like that. Absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there is foreign security problems with that for sure.
Oh, there, I know it's a problem with
Russia. America. I'm sure Russia would love to get their hands on those files and release it.
Oh, yeah. Well, a lot of their news is like about how America lies about stuff. Like, they have straight up newscasts that talk about how 9/11 was an inside job.
Yeah, yeah. And as of this Thursday morning, it was unclear exactly how many records are actually being kept secret still. The president did authorize the disclosure of 19,045 documents that are available on the National Archives website right now. So there is, he did release a bunch of them.
He did.
But they're probably all your boring stuff. So
wasn't there like 30 left or something?
No, there's more than that, I think. So yeah, it sounds like the next deadline for the release of more documents would be October 26, 2021.
That's so crazy. Because I believe they voted in 1992 to like keep it hidden, keep it sealed until 2017.
Yeah.
In 92. Well, yeah, 25 years. Yep, that's right.
Yeah, I know. It's so interesting.
They were like, the people have to, you know, have to know the truth. So this stuff has to come out by that year. But I think they thought Daddy Bush would be gone.
Yeah. Maybe. Yeah, I don't know, though. It might even be more than that.
It could definitely
be. I think it's probably deeper than that.
But I think, like, to me, that the fact that it's his names, like, he's like the name that really stands out, that would probably be in there. And a good reason for, like, why. Because, like, if it's just national security, like, why would they just push the release? They just wouldn't release it at all. Why would they even acknowledge, if it was really, like, a danger to release these, they wouldn't even let people know they had them.
Yeah, that's true too.
You know,
they probably would have been destroyed.
I feel like honestly, it's being withheld because they're waiting for something to happen or something, you know, like, because why would they just keep pushing it for no reason? So would they push it to?
Well, this is
Trump's like, make sure it's outside of my presidency so I don't get blamed for this.
Yeah, he's like, definitely outside of 8 years because I'm going to be here till then.
Well, it's not 8 years. It would be what?
2021.
3 years.
Oh, it's only like, yeah. But then they'll just push it back again because a former Washington Post staff writer who edits a JFKfacts.org website, which is devoted to Kennedy, named Jefferson Morley, he believes that the point is that the CIA wants to keep this secret forever. It's a very clear statement of intent. He believes that they're never going to release this stuff because it is that juicy and that they're kind of making us think. Like, they gave us the files they want to give us, but then they're just kind of...
It's just like a Band-Aid.
Hold these, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it could be.
I mean, what if it literally shows the whole fucking thing? What if it's the plan, to kill JFK?
Those files. There's no way that's like even... That was probably shredded.
What if it's like Operation Knockoff?
Oh my God, no way.
Jack.
There's no way that it's just straight up something like that. It's probably just like little juicy details that would give it away.
Never know.
Some of these black programs, I don't know.
You never know even what the fuck they're doing, but there could be Operation Knockoff Jack. Well, I know
that they would never release any documents like that.
Yeah.
If they would never even admit to those existing.
Maybe. Maybe we're on the verge of disclosure of a lot of shit, guys. God. Maybe. I think people often overlook that, but it's possible. We could get revealed a lot of fucking shit that will expose a lot of different things that are going on and, you know, flip the script. So, no, I just thought that was interesting. I think there's one more thing I wanted to share about this because apparently there's one document of an FBI report detailing an agent's interview of Oswald's brother, Robert, and mother, Marguerite, in April 1960. This document is dated July 1961 and refers to four confidential informants, codenamed T1, T2, T3, and T4, but their names are blacked out. This is a 57-year-old document, which is the Washington Post guy said, and all the names are still being withheld. Who the fuck is T1, T2, T3, T4?
Those are the people that you want to know. I bet you Bush is one of them, though.
Well, what do we think about Oswald? I mean...
Oh, he could even... He could have been...
I mean, it could implicate that they were working with him. Maybe that shit's in there.
God, I really wish they just released it. I was so excited. The day of the release, that was supposed to happen. I was like... Literally waiting. No, I know we all were. Like, checking, we're like, oh my God.
The truth, finally. They will give us the truth.
Even people, so even when we were in Australia, we were like on this tour with this guy, and he was super, super nice. Shout out if he happens to be watching. Oh, yeah.
Our mate. What was his name?
Paul.
Paul.
Paul. Our mate, Paul. Yeah, he was telling, he told me, he's like, if there was one thing I could know, it would be if JFK was assassinated. And he's Australian. I just thought that's so funny. Like, shows the reach of this theory and how many people believe it. Like, it's crazy. Most Americans believe it.
Yeah, yeah.
It's really, really nuts.
I know. It's crazy, man. But that's interesting. So I guess we'll have to wait and see if they release anything. But
we'll probably have a baby before that happens. Man.
Jesus.
God.
All right. This was another thing that was a big news this week that I wanted to talk about real quick because it's crazy. But Bill Cosby was convicted of drugging and molesting a woman this week. All three accounts are accounts of indecent sexual assault is what he got.
Yeah, he honestly got away easy a little bit.
And fucking Bill Cosby was like, I mean, I watched The Cosby Show growing up because, like, my parents were like, oh, this is a good, wholesome show to show the kids.
Oh, my God,
So we were always allowed to watch
Cosby The Cosby Show. Was, like, a huge part of my family. Like, I've seen him live. I saw him live at the Buell Theater.
Oh, wow, you did. I forgot you did.
I did, and it was one of my favorite shows. I just remember he was wearing sweatpants and Crocs, and I thought he was a badass. But, God, and he was, like, he did that cute, like, skit about the cake. Giving his daughter's cake. Like, he's everyone's, he's America's dad.
Yeah.
Oh, so disappointing. But it's really good to see, you know, some justice be served, a punishment happen. But I have to say, there's a lot of other white guys out there, Harvey Weinstein, Matt Lauer, many others, that will not get punished the way that Bill will. And I'm not saying Bill shouldn't get punished. Of course he should. But they should all be punished.
Right. It should be equal punishment for the same crime. I mean, it's ridiculous that
it's insane.
It's not that way. I mean, what year is it again? Pinch me. It's fucking seriously. 2018. Come on.
It's ridiculous.
Because Bill Cosby, who's 80 years old now, he's an old dude now, is going to spend his final years in prison.
Honestly, good. Like, I know they expressed some health concerns to the judge, though, so it's possible he may not.
He still claims he's innocent and that the encounter was consensual with
Temple University
employee Andrea Constand in 2004.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's good that he's going to jail, even though he's old, he's sick, he has some health problems. I think he should. I think
he's pretty senile at this point.
But still, like, you commit a crime, you need to be incarcerated for some period of time.
You got to have a consequence to these actions, you know.
Mm-hmm. And this is, like, it's so important to punish these men because it sends a message to all the other young men in Hollywood or, you know, in jobs, wherever. This is not going to fucking fly anymore. Like, you eventually, even if you're an old ass man, you'll go to jail.
It'll set a great example for
yes.
But it's got to be consistent.
I think all these newscasters,
that's the thing. If you got money, you got fame, you can slip out of a lot of shit in this world. So,
well, we saw it happen to a lot of big names this year. And I think a lot of people are thinking, like, younger men going into these industries, like, okay, I can't.
Can't fuck around.
You can't do that.
Can't fuck around and do some shit.
Go to the strip club, dude.
Go where it's legal to basically, like, touch, you know, like, don't, why, what are you doing? Like,
yeah, it really blows my mind. And we're going to be talking about a lot of graphic things about this kind of stuff today. And it's so crazy to me because, like, I think I'm really, really lucky to have been a woman who has never been sexually assaulted. The worst thing that's ever happened to me is a guy sent me a picture of his dick without warning me that he was going to send it. Just showed the fuck up.
But he was your boyfriend.
Yeah, but still. Okay. Don't do that. I was, like, really young. But that is the worst thing. And that is not harassment or assault. That is just, like, the closest thing I've ever come to that. And it's like, it makes me have so much like thinking what these women go through blows my mind.
Sure.
And it's really weird to be feeling lucky that this hasn't happened to
me. Oh, I know. I don't think most men have the capability to even for a moment even try to step in a woman's shoes,
yeah,
and really see what life is like. I honestly wish I could, because I think, yeah, it would help my evolution a lot, because I would just understand it better, yeah, and understand how you guys feel about, mm-hmm, it, and just I think it would help change a lot of people's minds, because like, dude, I wouldn't want the shit done to, like, are you kidding me?
Yeah,
like, if I was a girl, I wouldn't want some dude just walk and be like, ooh, like,
looking,
yeah, like,
I just pulled, you know, my, like, pants,
whatever,
down.
Yeah, it's like
the weirdest things. Like, it's so, it's bizarre. When you hear the,
like,
stories, you're,
look,
almost
naked,
like want to say that they're making it up, because it seems so insane. And but it's just like, these people actually do these things. It's unreal. And like, being a woman and just being afraid of crime, like, all the victims we talk about pretty much today, a couple,
yes,
men maybe, but
dude,
mostly women.
Right. This is a great example of the kind of monsters that are out there.
Yeah.
That,
and women have to be scared of it.
Yeah. Because
it's not
that you have
men
to be,
very often.
No, it's not men very often at all. It's like 1%.
There's a reason that most of the shows on ID are about women being murdered, you know?
Yep.
So
there is a show called Women Who Kill, though.
Oh, hell yeah. Some bitches can kill, for
yeah,
sure.
And there's, yeah. But no, you're absolutely right, because I think sexual assault is just like way more prominent with men. I don't know. It could be a primal thing. I don't know.
I think
don't fully
it is a primal thing. I think it
has to do with some primal instincts there, because it is just like animal. It's just like,
yeah,
animals.
I mean, you'd
like,
have to be like, I mean, these women are in fear when this is happening to them. For you to like
that's an animal
like
thing
pursue
to do
through that, like, it's so bizarre.
Sure.
I can't even understand it. But I'm glad he's going to jail.
Listen to this, though.
I hope
today,
some more people do.
Or, yeah. When he got the verdict, Cosby lashed out loud as fuck at District Attorney Kevin Steele and called him an asshole after the prosecutor asked that Cosby be immediately jailed because he might flee. Cosby denied he has an airplane and shouted, "I'm sick of him." He, like, shouted out in the courtroom. I think there's video of it, too. But apparently he's going to be free on bail while he waits sentencing. Shrieks erupted when the verdict was announced. Some of his accusers whimpered and cried. Wow. I'm sure it was a great day for the victims of Bill Cosby, though. Yeah, justice has been done.
Oh, yeah. I heard them
2-week
today.
Retrial. They put 5 women on the stand who testified that Cosby, who was married for 54 years, drugged and violated them. One of those women asked him through tears, "You remember, don't you, Mr. Cosby?" Wow.
Yep.
Deliberated for 14 hours over 2 days. He could get up to 10 years in prison on each of the 3 counts
of
aggravated
indecent
assault.
He'll probably be in prison for the rest of his life.
He'll likely get less
Chances
than that
are.
Under the state sentencing guidelines, but given his age,
yeah, he's probably gonna
he
die
will
in
die
there.
Behind bars. He's going to go behind bars, I think. Don't you agree?
I think so. And I think because he's black, the judge will be harder on him, I think, to be honest. I mean, look how this people get away with it. It's insane. So many white guys get away with this shit.
Yeah, yeah.
It's crazy. I want to see Harvey Weinstein in chains. I want to see Matt Lauer in chains. That's a little bit dramatic, but
we need a chain gang.
I
want
to see some fucking accountability for these men that think they can do this to women. It's unreal.
Or just go to rehab for like 30 days.
No,
like,
rehab.
I'm addicted to sex, so
yes,
I have
exactly.
to sexually assault women.
Yeah, the re.
It's like, no.
You're
no,
not
no,
withdrawing
no.
from it.
That's
so
not
no.
even a real diagnosis for one. And
no.
B, that is a lame excuse for fucking assaulting people.
Yeah.
Like, would you want that shit to happen to you? No, you wouldn't want that shit to happen to you.
No.
So speaking of motherfuckers that, you know, sorry. But speaking of fucking terrible people that sexually assault people, today we are talking about the Golden State Killer, aka the East Area Rapist.
Yes,
this mother, I keep wanting to call him a motherfucker because he is one, but
okay, let's not call him that though.
This guy, this evil ass guy,
yeah, well, this week they arrested a suspect. So
yes.
We're going to tell you all about that.
Oh, yeah.
But that's the big piece of news here.
So this is literally...
this has been in years.
Longest running serial killer cold case in U.S. history.
Yeah.
If I don't know if it's the one, but it is one of the longest. It might even be the longest. And this week, the authorities arrested a man by the name Joseph James D'Angelo, who's now 72 years old, and have charged him with, I believe that he's only charged with two accounts right now of murder. But he is a suspect of this immense crime spree, guys. This is so much shit he did.
And I have to say, like, I first heard of this a couple months ago, actually. Like, I hadn't known about this one. I don't think a lot of people do. It's like one of the biggest serial killer cases.
I didn't know about it.
Yeah, and it's crazy. It was like the biggest serial killer in California, and people didn't know about it until like recently. This woman, Michelle McNamara, she was married to Patton Oswalt, who's a comedian, and she was a true crime writer. And she studied this case for years, and her writing is really incredible in the book. Like, I've listened to some of it, read, you heard it today, and it sounds like a really, really good read. So I might have to like do something with Audible for that, because it's like, I have got to read that, her recounting of it. But basically this woman, she passed away, Patton Oswalt's wife, while she was working on this, and she was about 3/4 of the way done. And Patton Oswalt finished the book, and
he had
people do it. But basically, it's really thanks to her that this case started getting attention again, and things started picking up. And it might even be possible, thanks to her, that he was found.
It's possible. Absolutely.
It definitely could have put more resources towards it, because they want to solve things that the public's care about most.
Yeah, so absolutely.
Her doing that, because she called him the Golden State Killer.
Right.
So
she really kind of tied all the loose ends together and made this kind of like started this unified hunt for the Golden State Killer.
Yeah.
Because this guy did at least 12 homicides, at least 50 rapes, and 120 burglaries between 1979 and 1986. And before the writer named him the Golden State Killer, he was the East Area Rapist. What he was known as during that time in the 70s and 80s. So where does this story of this crazy serial killer crime spree begin?
Crime spree? We're going on spree. A crime spree.
God, you're killing me.
All right.
Where does this crime spree begin? You know, sometimes you just gotta like pop the seriousness for a moment and laugh before you jump into.
Oh, dude, you have to crazy with these topics. Shit. People don't understand it, too, either. Because like, I have to like have some humor and some like, because like it gets exhausting talking about killers and shit all the time.
So much death.
Like, you have to, like, keep, or you're going to go insane.
Oh, yeah. I mean, unless you're literally built for this shit, but this is, like, this is dark shit. This guy's a evil fucker, man.
Yeah, this is pretty upsetting.
So
let's jump in.
So, this East Area Rapist, a.k.a. Golden State Killer, began his crime spree attacking teens and women who were home alone or with young children before switching to targeting couples.
Oh my God, the story, like, I watched this documentary on this yesterday, and the story of one of the women, like, her husband left for work and she was in bed, and her son came and got in bed with her, and she heard
footsteps
and thought it was him and was like, hey, like, what'd you forget? Yeah. And then it was like this guy in a ski mask, and thank God he didn't kill her or her. He like took a knife and like made a design on her chest to like show power. But he didn't hurt her son. He was removed from the room, and then he raped her.
Yeah.
But he left, and he left them alive, and he put her son, like, just, like, back in bed with her and, like, left.
Yeah, no, I know. That's so lucky. But, yeah, no, he started this, you know, spree with the raping. He didn't start murdering yet. He started with just raping, and that's what, she was one of the first victims, I think, actually, of his.
Yeah.
So, people, and there was at least 50. So there's a lot of experiences that happen, but overall the consensus is that the police said that he would stalk couples for weeks trying to figure out their habits and home security before attacking.
Yeah.
And when he would strike, he would often appear near the foot of his victims' beds with a weapon in the middle of the night.
Yeah.
Often not wearing pants too.
Jesus.
This guy was like a creepy, he had like some sexual creepy fantasy going on with this too. And the media's left that out a lot because it's just weird and creepy.
Oh,
and
really?
These are details that they didn't want to talk about, like, because it's TV, like, because he's like,
it's a little freaky.
I mean, even in the documentary we were watching about it on HLN or something, we didn't talk about this. They talked about this, you know, like semen that's found, the sperm that's found all over the victim's like beds, but they didn't mention that they recount when the victims recounted their experiences, he was often not wearing pants. And he would force the woman to tie up the man, and then he'd tie up the woman. And then he'd make the man lie on his stomach, and he'd often put dishes on top of him, and then telling the men that if they rattled, he'd hurt or kill the woman he was raping. Can you imagine that? I can't. That just like fucking destroyed me. I'm like, oh my God, if that happened to me, that'd be just so insane.
And I know. I can't even wrap my mind.
My life would, so I feel like my life would be over. Like, that'd just be so traumatic and crazy. Oh, having dishes, God. Like, oh my God, that's just crazy.
That's so scary.
It's so scary. And this guy is just creepy, dude. Like, he just liked to play with people, basically. And after he was done raping, he'd sometimes stay in their house even longer, making himself a sandwich or having a beer. And then he'd do a little ransacking and rummaging through like their drawers and shit.
Which is incredible, because his DNA must be everywhere. If he was eating things and making things and rummaging,
seriously,
crazy. Most criminals try not to touch fucking
anything. I mean, he probably had gloves and on and stuff. I'm sure he was smart enough to not.
But you have, not leave you have DNA. The risk of hair falling out.
It's true.
Spit. Skin flakes. Yeah,
very true.
There's probably
DNA all over those crime scenes.
Avoid it. Avoid that as much as you
fucking
could.
Get it. They couldn't figure out how to get it yet.
Yeah.
Or really understand DNA at that
time. Well, DNA is like
changed the game. Completely changed the game.
Yep. Well, that's how they're who was it? I can't even remember which case. They just solved one with DNA. Anyway.
So during the beginning of his crime spree, the only information really that police knew was that the East Area Rapist or Golden State Killer always wore a ski mask when he attacked couples. That was his kind of trademark thing. And the way that he kept himself anonymous is that he always wore a ski mask, and he always would try to shine lights in people's eyes. He would yell at victims to not look at him. So he did a good job, I guess, keeping his identity, you know, completely unknown.
Yeah.
In all of these things. Because, I mean, as soon as people identify you, like, game's over. You're going to get caught.
Oh, yeah.
But the fact that he was able to really control the situations, keep them from looking at him, blindfolding, gagging, all that.
Clearly a smart criminal. He reminds me of, like, Dexter.
Yes. No, this whole thing reminds me of, like, serial killers.
Even though Dexter was not evil and definitely wasn't.
There was another one on Dexter that reminded me of him. He didn't work for, like, law enforcement or anything, but he
was on the show.
Was just, like, a regular Joe dad. That was like murdering people on the side, like in secret. Like, it was, it's this kind of
Dexter's
thing.
Dexter's such a wild show. Guys, if you've never seen it, like, seriously, you have to.
And if you're interested
watch
in this, gotta watch it.
Oh my God.
Must watch.
Must watch if you like my channel at all.
So, yeah, no, it's such a good show. But so police literally did not know much about him. They basically believed that he was a young white man at the time, and he was close to 6 feet tall with blonde or light brown hair. That's all they knew about who this guy was. Based upon, you know, victim testimony and things like that.
Which is always really hard because people are so shooken up. It's hard to remember everything right.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And this is interesting, too. They also knew from the victims that he was slender and in good shape, but had an unusually tiny penis. The fact that they used tiny penis is actually
of course he did.
Funny, but.
Well, no but wonder he felt the need to do all
power,
this stuff.
He needs, power. Right, he needs to feel like he's adequate and can...
Wow.
That really explains his sort of... There is definitely passion behind these crimes. Like, he really felt like he probably needed to do this for himself to, like, pump himself up or something. Like,
so weird.
But that was an actual detail that was given. And actually, when FBI got involved later, they actually believe that the East Area Rapist started out as the Visalia Ransacker, who's a man who burglarized about 80 homes before the East Area Rapist even came about. And the reason that is because this dude would literally scope out his victim, figure out who they are, watch them, figure out how to get inside, wait, know their schedules, know when the woman was by themselves. And oftentimes, guys, this guy would literally break into the home somehow before. I'm sure it was like super easy in the 70s to get into people's houses because people didn't leave their doors locked and stuff. Yeah. And like the locks probably weren't hard to like jam open and stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But he would go into the victims' houses, and not only would he plant like tools and shit that he would need, rope and shit, but sometimes he'd even hide in there and then wait for them to come and then just wait in there until they left and he had the opportunity.
Oh, that's so fucking creepy.
He was the ultimate, like the ultimate scary dude we all have had dreams about, you know, that,
that
you don't
like
want
comes
to, fall,
to your house.
You don't want to come after you. He was that guy because he was tactical. He understood, you know, he was going for maximum terror was his goal. To really freak you out and completely just haunt you, pretty much.
Wow.
So, police did know at the time when he started that most likely the person, you know, that they would be interested in being a suspect of these crimes would have training in military or law enforcement techniques, as well as being proficient with firearms. Because the way that the Golden State Killer moved about, got away, he was very tactical about it. He was able to somehow evade being caught over and over and over again. And it could have been largely due to previous experience he had in the military, which we'll talk about later. But in 1977, so many women in the Sacramento area were being attacked. Police started holding town hall meetings for concerned women. And at one town hall, according to a paper, Crime Watch Daily, a man who was with his wife cast doubt on the case. And the man said he absolutely could not believe that a rapist would come into a home and rape a woman while the husband was in bed with her. Carol Daly, who was one of the survivors of the first attacks by the suspect. This is an interview she did with Crime Watch Daily. And several months later, that husband and his wife were victims of the East Area Rapist. The people that said they couldn't believe that this could happen. They're like, oh, there's no way somebody could do that. They fucking got murdered by the East Area Rapist.
Oh my God.
And that this crime reporter said she believes the rapist or the Golden State Killer was at that meeting. And then he literally could have just followed them from there and just chose them as random. So he's literally like a serial killer that's doing this for fun. He's getting some sort of fulfillment from it that he is feeding
it's
off
like
of.
Dexter, born in blood.
Right.
Just like has to do it.
Yes, exactly.
That's so weird.
Yeah, it is so weird, dude.
I wonder if he started with like killing pets and stuff since so many serial killers do that.
Yeah, I know. So here is a survivor's account of their experience.
Oh my God, is this going to scare me?
We'll see.
Oh, great. How scary is it?
I woke up with a hand over my mouth and I rolled out of bed. I just swung my arm. I said, what are you doing? He was going down the hall and he was just hitting me. And then I just pretended that he knocked me out, so he quit hitting me. And then I had sock stuffed in my mouth, blindfolded, gagged, hands tied, legs tied. And then, you know, pulled me up like this because I was on my stomach and put me back in bed and said, if you move, I'm going to kill you. So, you know, lay there for 2 hours. And he came in, I don't know, I think 5 different times or something like that over the course of the night and raped me. And while you're laying there thinking you're going to die, you just are pretty sure that, you know, I mean, I remember just kind of being in shock. I'm just laying there on my stomach shivering because I had a fever. And you know how you get the chills and you shake finally, after, I mean, our best guess is 2 hours. It went on a long time. At about 4:30 in the morning, I had heard a car drive away, and I started counting to 60 because I didn't have any concept of time. So I counted to 60 30 times, and I figured then a half hour would have gone by with no noise in the house, and I got up and didn't know if he was there. I used to say, and I'm sure that, you know, who knows, I remember saying when it was still going on, if they ever catch this guy, They should lay him on the floor and let everybody that he raped get to do whatever they want to him. You know, I just thought that's what we should get to do.
Totally.
And then that thought kind of went away. But I thought, you know, we should get to do what we want. You know, we had to go through this.
God.
I don't
so angry.
Think that I would need to hurt him. You know, if he was caught, I don't need to get any revenge. I don't need anything like that. I just liked it. There to be closure, but I have to say, you know, it's felt pretty closed to me for a long time. I'm always aware of anybody coming up behind me.
Me too.
And it's not a fear. I don't have a fear with that. I'm just aware. I look over my shoulder all the time.
Yeah. I used to walk with keys in my hand ready to stab.
You know, it's just the way, I'm sure that came out of it, but that's my, I guess, you know, my rationalization that I can do all these things because I'm super aware of what's going on. I have to do a lot of self-talk when my husband's away for the weekend. I have to tell myself that there's somebody next door that's a single woman that stays home every night by herself and she hasn't been attacked. I mean, I have to do this every time he goes away. And he doesn't go away very much, maybe at the most once a year. But I don't just peacefully go to sleep every night.
Yeah, I can imagine. God, that was brutal.
Wow.
Extremely sad.
That is just, I mean,
I can't even imagine.
That's terrifying. I mean, that terrifies me to my core. Like, that's just, and I totally understand those feelings of wanting, you know, wanting to, why can't we reciprocate that pain to him that he caused us? You know, why can't we?
Well, thank God they caught him.
I know.
Because now at least he'll get something.
At least he's going to, at least he has to fucking like own up to this shit, you know?
And face everyone he knows and face his kid. Doesn't he have kids?
Yeah, dude.
Oh my God. They must be like, Dad, what the fuck?
Yeah. They're going to find out their dad was a sick psycho creep because he would call his victims before or after attacking them, taunting them,
so scary.
Or threatening them. And he once called a victim and said, Merry Christmas, it's me again. And he does it in a creepy ass voice. And I'll show you in a sec.
Yeah.
And another time he called the police to say, you're never going to catch me. It's the East Area Rapist, you dumb fuckers. He did do that. I mean, it's so obvious that he's doing this for the rush, or it's giving him power that he never had or something.
Mm-hmm.
So once in 1977, he actually called the sheriff's department and told them, I'm going to hit tonight, Watt Avenue. And police put patrollers out. And sure enough, they saw a man in a ski mask riding a bike over the Watt Avenue Bridge.
What?
Yeah, but he was able to escape. He was able to escape. He always had
this guy Batman? Like, what the hell?
He spent all his time, I guarantee you, thinking about these attacks. He fantasized. It's so obvious. He literally fantasized about them and then made them reality however he wanted. He planned out his escape route. Police said that he knew exactly how far away from areas where there was tons of trees were. He would run. He would go exactly to where he needed to be in order to evade capture.
Wow.
And they were never able to get I mean, he totally spent
who tells tons of brain where they're going to be and then like still gets away. That's amazing.
Again, this is, I mean, nowadays, fuck no, you're not going to get away, dude. They're going to find you. They got helicopters. I mean, they got dogs. I mean, it's not happening
these
days.
Oh, they didn't have dogs back then? I didn't know that.
Yeah, so here's, I'm going to
She just did not listen to that. That was sarcastic. You're like, yeah.
Sorry.
They did have dogs.
They did have dogs. They did track them with bloodhounds, things like
dogs
that.
Dogs are a new thing. You didn't know? Dogs
they got
just
robot
came
dogs
out.
Now, all right? These robot dogs can, they can pick up trails that the real ones can't, all right?
Okay.
So, no, but I'm going to play you the phone call from that night.
Oh, God.
And
this is creepy, too.
He was also known as the original Night Stalker, too, due to being a suspect in other crimes in another area. I'll talk about that in a sec. But here's that phone call, because this is interesting. All right.
Fuck.
Why does it sound 5 years old? Sounds like a kid. Oh, that's so creepy. Turn it off. It's like The Grudge. Ugh. Turn this shit off. They got enough. They're probably like, ugh, please.
And then he...
ugh. Gross.
And then he goes on to proceed to do that over and over again. And he purposely made it creepy. He obviously thought about, how do I make this as fucking creepy as possible? That was not his voice, dude. I don't know who that was then. That was weird.
I don't think that was his voice.
No?
He's like a huge dude. Yeah. Isn't he like really big?
Yeah. Well, he used to be. Well, he's big now, but he used to be like in shape. He used to be in like really good shape.
Yeah, because he was a cop.
Slender dude. Yeah. Which I'll talk about in a sec.
Oh, sorry.
No.
Josh wants to go in the order, okay? It's okay.
Back to the plan.
Okay.
It's all good. So then crimes actually moved areas into Northern California, or actually, I'm sorry, the crimes that did occur in the Northern California area occurred from 1976 through 1979. And at some point in 1979, however, the killer moved down the coast. Sorry, he started doing the crimes in the north, and then he moved locations and he went south.
Mm.
And that's when these similar type of crimes popped up, and he was... the suspect of whoever did these crimes in Southern California was dubbed the original Night Stalker. So that's how that got slapped on him too.
So he was the original Night Stalker and the East Area Rapist. And then later he was deemed
the
Golden State Killer.
Exactly. And this is where things just, shit gets real. And things got very serious because he did kill two people in Northern California, and did evade being caught. I'll tell you the details of that in a sec. And then in Southern California, he then proceeded to kill 10 people, often capping off. And not only that, but he'd rape, kill, and bludgeon people to death. So here is, this is, all right, explicit warning. This is where the details might be a little graphic here, okay? Because this is a breakdown of all of his killings.
Video deleted from YouTube.
Seriously. On February 2nd, 1978, the first two victims were husband and wife Brian and Kate Majori. Do you know how to say that? Majori?
Majori? Oh, that looks like Magyar.
No, that's not it. It's like Majori, who were walking their dog in their Rancho Cordova neighborhood. And at some point during their walk, they encountered a man wearing a ski mask and holding a gun. And all three ended up in the neighbor's backyard, where the suspect gunned down the couple and then tried to flee. So that was the first time. Remember, that's the one that that's the one where the husband was, I think he was in the military, and he attacked the killer
back,
attacked him back, and actually attacked him and chased him, and then he ended up shooting the husband because he lost control. He was like, fuck, these guys are out in public.
So that was the first person he killed, and he didn't mean to kill them.
Right. Well, it wasn't the plan to kill them.
Wasn't a part of his
original I think he was smart in the fact that he didn't want to get murder charges. Initially, I think he was just doing the rapes and getting away with it. It was like, all right, this is good. I don't have any murders. It's just rape or whatever. But then this happened, and he had he got dumb, I guess, in the sense of a criminal, that he started attacking couples with males there. He got cocky and was like, hey, I can go fuck up
with a guy. But
I'll do it.
I think
right
that was part of his like fantasy with it too. It's like doing it in front of a husband.
Totally. So, but that's where he fucked up, because guys are going to be like, hell no, I'm not going down without a fight. And then, so he had to end up killing the
dude.
Majori couple.
And then, so he went back and killed her after he killed the guy.
Okay. Yeah, because they were already outside, and people are like starting to, you got to take care of that situation fast and get out of there. So that's what he did. So he evaded capture then. And then on December 30th, 1979, the third and fourth killings came the following year in Goleta. And authorities said that the suspect entered the home of Dr. Robert Offerman through a sliding glass door and found him and clinical psychologist Alexandria Manning sleeping in bed. And he tied the couple up and then shot them both. So that was a very big deal. And there was obviously a sexual fantasy there. He was obsessed with this female doctor or psychologist, Alexandria Manning. And so he in every single event, he raped and then killed them. And then on March 13th, 1980, the fifth and sixth victims were killed in Ventura. And authorities say that the suspect tied up Lyman Smith, 43, and his wife Charlene Smith, 33, and then raped her in front of him. He then tied them up using a drapery cord and secured it with a diamond knot, which was his signature knot. And that was one of the things that authorities caught on to, was that the knots were very intricate, and somebody probably in law enforcement or the military or something along those lines would have those, have those skills to tie those types of knots. But he ended up bludgeoning this couple to death with a fireplace log. Like, he was just brutal, man. Like, he showed no mercy. He just was addicted to the violence, I guess, and the blood that was probably, like, I can't even imagine these crime scenes. I just don't understand how he didn't leave traces behind him. That's because that's serious stuff, man. That's like,
I don't get how he didn't
major,
leave. It's major really crime crazy. Scene. And he did so many of them. It's just so bizarre that it's there was crazy. No like DNA. And the fact that he would just like hang out there.
Yeah.
So weird.
Then he went on in August 1980. He ended up killing a medical student named Keith Harrington, who was 24. And he beat him to death along with his wife, who was a pediatric nurse, in their home.
Ugh.
He just popped into their home and beat them both to death. Tied up, blind. Like, what the hell, dude? He was obsessed with beating up and bludgeoning victims.
Yeah.
Because he did it again in February of 1981 when Manuela Whithun, who was 28, was bludgeoned to death in her home in Irvine.
Jesus.
Her dad discovered her after he went to check on her when her employers told him she hadn't shown up for work. He just came home and just randomly, random victims, it seems like. It seems like his victims just were his choice. He just picked victims that would be easy targets, I guess.
Like what's so interesting about killers like this. Like people who aren't, these aren't revenge murders. They're not going after someone because they're angry at them, because those are so different. Honestly, those end up sometimes worse, like even more, you know, because they're angry at this person.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
But you have to be a special kind of psychopath to just do this to random people. Like there's something in you that doesn't have any compassion. Like to be able to end someone's life. Can you ever imagine?
No.
Imagine ending someone's life.
Absolutely not.
No way. Not even a million years.
I can't even think to end my own life. I'm like, let alone somebody else's life. Like,
yeah.
That's so, just, I don't understand.
To do that again and again and again and sleep with it and live with it and be that and be proud of it.
Just in the most personal, brutal forms. Like, the raping and just like, I can't, like, that's just so crazy and just so barbarian, like to do that to victim after victim after victim after victim and just keep doing it over and over again and listen to people die. Like that alone in itself is probably just makes the problem way worse. Like you do it once and then it gets in your head. And then, you know, that's PTSD or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah,
and
at that point,
it gets worse and worse. And you just spiral out of control and you just go down this like wormhole.
Well, I already killed this person.
Brutality.
I might as well kill this person and this person. Yeah.
Just keep going because it's what's kind of fueling me at this point. And this dude in July of 1981, his next victims were Sherry Domingo, who's 35, Gregory Sanchez, who's 27, and Goleta.
I have a question.
Yes.
Just before I forget.
Sure.
Since he was just like raping people in the beginning, like maybe he didn't have that like killing.
No, he was raping the whole time. He raped all the way.
No, through. I know.
Yeah.
But he wasn't killing at first.
No.
So maybe he didn't have that serial killer thing that you just want to kill someone. He just wanted to rape people. It's kind of interesting. He kind of like ended up in the serial killer life by accident, seems like. He just became something that he wasn't like born like needing to kill people.
Yeah.
Like some serial killers.
You
want to
know my theory?
Sure.
My theory is that he got into this for the sexual satisfaction of, you know, sexually assaulting innocent women because it made him feel powerful. He obviously had confidence problems and, you know, he had a lot of issues. So this was, I mean, it doesn't help, but he, you know, he just went to the extreme with it. And I think he never, I don't know. I don't think he probably intended to kill people. I think that kind of just, it was a thing in the back of his mind. Like if it ever comes down to it, I'll evade capture and kill somebody if I have to. But he made a mistake and he ended up having to kill those people. And then after that, I think maybe he was like, well, now I already have murder charges. I'm screwed. I've raped all these women. I'm going to go away forever anyway, or
might as well
get the death penalty. So
hard.
Might as well just go out with a bang, you know? So he decided to then just proceed doing that, or maybe he got a rush or some like satisfaction, which is probably what it was. I'm thinking
he probably just enjoyed it and was like, wow, okay, that was kind of fun. And I got away with it. Yeah. I was able to do it. And like, when I've done it once, now I can do it twice.
Yeah. Crazy. Yeah. But yeah, so his next victims were Sherry Domingo, 35, Gregory Sanchez, 27, and Goleta. And Domingo was a corporate manager, and Sanchez was a Burroughs Corp employee, and they were both killed in their home. And he probably got satisfaction from killing people in their home, because that's like, I think that's like kind of the ultimate killer, serial killer MO, so is to like kill somebody in a place where they think they're safe, you know, in like their house, versus like somewhere public or somewhere unknown.
Yeah, but it's also because it like, you can control the scene a lot more than if it's in public. I mean, who would go like serial killer in public?
That's true. There's not anybody watching, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, it is unexpected for sure. That is definitely, I mean, that's why when you're like walking, like, I know we probably have a lot of ladies listening and men too. Everyone should be safe. If you're walking at night, like, you should never stare at your phone, because that's what they're looking for. People who are distracted,
easy to take you out.
Their phone,
easy to take you out if you're on your phone.
You gotta look like you know what you're doing. Look around. You have a fucking mission. Get your car keys in your hands.
Pepper spray.
I always carried pepper spray, mace. I think in this fucking world, you kind of have to. I have a taser.
Get your sword out. I don't
know where my taser is, though. I used to carry it around in college. I remember used to show it in YouTube videos.
It's really unfortunate that our society has progressed to this point where we have to be fearful. I mean,
yeah,
I'm not going to lie. I'm a pretty big dude, and I'm bigger than most people I'm walking around with.
Uh-huh.
But yet I still, that like, it's not even about that anymore. I'm like, I could be as big and strong as I want to be, but somebody, some crazy fuck that wants to kill me could kill me at any point in time. And I probably couldn't stop it. So I always try to at least give myself a fighting chance. And like, you know, I'm aware of my surroundings, especially in crowds and public places. I'm really more aware and cautious and just always like scanning and looking around. But it's just, it sucks that we've gotten to this point where we have to live in fear, it seems like.
Yeah, I mean, dude.
And we don't have to. That's the thing. We can make it a society where people feel safe and we can all be, you know, open and not have to feel like we have to look over our shoulders all the time. So, but yeah, these guys, these three victims were killed a half a mile away from where the Golden State Killer killed the Offerman, the doctor, in 1979. And he actually shot Sanchez and then bludgeoned him in his bed. And then Domingo had been tied up and died of massive head injuries. So he just straight up just like bashed people's heads in until they died.
Jeez.
Was his preferred method of killing. Which is like, it just is so obvious that it's a power trip for him. Like he gets that powerful feeling when he's fucking bludgeoning people. Yeah. And then in 1986, he raped and killed an 18-year-old Janelle Cruz in her home.
Jesus.
But that's where the rapes and the murders ended, in 1986. And that's when this case went cold. As far as we know. Yeah, there might be.
There could have definitely been some that weren't like part of his normal. Absolutely. Like, because right now, these are just the ones that were like part of his normal. Like, they were able to tie him to, or it was like he did the same things.
Well, it was like in a very small area. Like, they were very,
it was repeating the style is what I'm saying.
Very, like, similar. What he was doing. It was clear it was a serial killer.
Yeah.
Who did these murders and rapes.
Yeah.
But then as far as what we know, it went cold. So that's where this became a cold case, because they never identified the person. They didn't know who did it. They kind of had an idea of what he looked like. They had sketches and things like that, but they didn't have any way to identify this person and stick a charge to them. But like you mentioned at the beginning of this, that's where national interest kind of ignited things with this year, with her book, Michelle
McNamara,
right, the crime writer, with her book I'll Be Gone in the Dark, which is all about the Golden State Killer. She was very, very fascinated by this killer, and which rightfully so. I mean, if you're a true crime fan, this is like,
Well, this there's, is like, and it's kind of crazy, but there's a lot of people that think that in a way this case kind of ended her life, because she was so obsessed with it. She was so into it. She couldn't sleep. She was having trouble sleeping, and overdosed on sleeping medication and Xanax, right?
Yeah, it was fentanyl, Xanax, and then something else. Yeah, it was a bad concoction. She had a heart problem.
Probably trying to sleep.
But yeah, this writer was actually the one that like kind of renamed it. He's always been known as the East Area Rapist or, you know, Night Stalker. Yeah. So she was the one recently, that renamed him. So, but what's interesting though that I did want to mention about the book and about this crime writer is that the Sacramento Sheriff Scott Jones said in at a news conference on Wednesday that McNamara's book did not specifically lead to any new information about the Golden State Killer. But the book's release undeniably helped keep the unsolved case in the national public consciousness. So like some people are like, it's the exact reason for why they solved it. And according to the sheriff's department, they're saying that it didn't provide any new information. It was just kind of a way to like bring the story back to, you know, everybody's minds. Yeah.
Oh yeah. No, it wasn't like there was like
specific information that they got from.
No. It just gave more resources to the case. More eyes on it equals more money going towards it.
Right. But one of the problems with this case and why part of the reason why it took so long to solve is because the attacks spanned the entire state of California, and California is a huge state.
Yes.
So it took a while for investigators to actually be able to link the cases together.
Yeah, they didn't know that the two were connected.
Exactly.
But then they're like, wait, so these are all the same things are happening.
Right.
So this is the same person.
And really what they were doing was waiting for DNA evidence.
Choking on your own.
Yeah. Waiting for DNA evidence or DNA. What do you call it? Forensics to get up to speed and actually be reliable.
Yeah.
Because
DNA's come a long way in 10 years. God, what case was it that I was curious about? I don't remember.
Because that's when in 2011 is when they had DNA tests which matched evidence linking the two cases together. So that's how they were finally able to be like, all right, there's evidence at both. Most likely it's the same person.
And God, I can't, it's so weird like seeing him old. Cause like in my head, the whole time we've been talking about this, I've been thinking of him that age, like him, this old man.
Oh yeah, I know. No, he was like a young, decent looking dude. Like wasn't
like his drawing, you know, the thing was pretty good looking.
He looked
like my neighbor growing up.
Yeah. He looked like just your average Joe, pretty much.
Yeah, now he's like this old man. It's just really weird to see.
No, I know, it's really bizarre, because he was captured this week, and in 2016 is when the FBI announced a reward for $50,000 in the case, and that's when they created the police sketches and really got, you know, kind of things buzzing with the Golden State Killer. But they knew even back in 2011 that this guy was that he was very tactical in the way that he operated. And they knew that this guy was probably in law enforcement. That's exactly what we found out. So he was captured. Before 2001, detectives in California knew there had been a string of unsolved murders and rapes in Southern California instead of attacks in Northern California. But a criminalist in Contra Costa County was the one that finally linked the two sets. Oh, right. That's the DNA. So that's when they linked the two sets of DNA together. And it was that DNA that led detectives to Mr. Joseph D'Angelo last week. And the authorities have just released new details on how they tracked him down. And this is interesting. So this is how they were basically able to track him down through public genealogy websites that have databases. I'll play you just here's how they broke the case open. They explain it better.
Tonight about the role of Florida company played in taking down the man suspected of being the Golden State Killer.
ABC Action News reporter Michael Paluska shows us how the new DNA business's website cracked the decades-old case.
Suspected serial killer Joseph D'Angelo, eluding capture for decades, finally taken down by an unsuspecting relative who uploaded their DNA to GetMatch.com. Investigators finding a family connection to D'Angelo's DNA, then meticulously working their way through his family tree.
It's not surprising that they can do that.
Kelsey Henschel Fay is a forensic anthropologist at USF. She does the same thing investigators did to track D'Angelo down, only her
this
research
is like really
identifies
controversial.
Human remains.
This whole
is it possible that this is
using people's
guy?
DNA?
And she can only access law enforcement database.
Yeah, yeah. No.
Like it is people, there's a lot of debate on this. Like, should they be able to do it? Because like in instances like this, it's really good. They're catching people, but it's like
then it's
crazy.
Like,
okay, so if you're on these DNA websites,
forget
which
being
we are,
anonymous,
we get,
you're gonna be found if your DNA is out there.
Yep. Which is could be why they're doing it. Somebody and the thumbprints.
That's
on the
crazy
iPhones
though, from a relative
stuff.
That up. God,
yeah,
like your relative spoiled it for you.
Yeah, he Someone screwed you. Wow, that's someone wanted crazy. To know their DNA.
Well, how was he supposed to account for like what the future, what would happen in the future? I mean, God.
Yeah.
But yeah, they once they kind of.
He was like eventually thought he would get caught and was like surprised, honestly, he had that it long. It looked like ridiculous.
No, I know. But once they kind of figured out who it was, they set up surveillance on him. And then they were able to secretly collect his DNA from two items he had discarded. So that's how they got his DNA. They surveilled him and then out of his trash basically took items that had his DNA on it. And they checked them together and boom, match. And they're like, bam. Got him.
Done. Wow. That must have been like the detective who did that. It makes me so sad for Michelle, though, like Ann Patton, that, you know, she spent her whole life, like, or a lot of time in her life trying to figure this out. It's the one thing she wanted was for him to be captured, that she was like, that's all I care about. So it's just kind of sad that like it happened after she died, but like maybe she knows, who knows?
Yeah, I know. Who knows? But you got to just hear about who this guy is, who the Golden State Killer is.
Oh yeah,
this Joseph is wild. D'Angelo. So D'Angelo was born in New York State and graduated from high school east of Sacramento. He enlisted in the Navy and fought in Vietnam, then returned and got a bachelor's degree in criminal justice. And from 1973 to 1976, he worked as a police officer in Exeter, California, close to the city of Visalia, which in 1974 and 1975 was terrorized by 85 burglaries and a murder and a series of crimes attributed to the perpetrator that they called the Visalia Ransacker.
Oh, it's probably him.
Probably fucking him. He started early. He became a cop and realized, I can fucking get away with this shit.
Yeah, and now I know how
I'm the cop. Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
you know the other side.
And then in 1976, he became a police officer in Auburn, California, until he was terminated for shoplifting, I think, rat poison and a hammer, which he used in a murder.
He got caught stealing a murder weapon, and they didn't do any, they let this guy go.
They just fired him.
Yeah. So they're like, all right, whatever.
So this crazy, sick fuck got married, actually, in 1973 and later divorced and was living with a daughter and granddaughter until he was arrested this week.
Wow. I wonder if they knew.
That's crazy.
It'll be so interesting
to see what else comes out.
There'll probably be a huge documentary or a movie that comes out about this whole thing.
The FBI thinks that the time frame of the crime supports that the suspect was a police officer when he committed some of these crimes. Yeah. That's fucking crazy, man. That's so crazy.
I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of unsolved cases are police.
Dude, that's a twist. Oh, man.
Because they know how to get away with it. Obviously, the people who are getting away with it are the smartest ones, the ones who know the system the best and how to do it. What things you need to be careful of and like what mistakes not to make.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, look at Dexter. I mean, that's exactly. Yeah. You understand how a crime scene works. You understand what the police look for. You can always stay five steps ahead of the police. Yeah. You can always know what's going on
because
you're in the police. So you know what they're looking, who they're searching for.
Yeah. What they're on
it's real life Dexter right here, pretty much. But after he got fired as a cop, he went on to just for the last 27 years, he's just worked at a grocery store distribution center as a mechanic.
Wow.
And he just retired in 2017.
Happy retirement. Enjoy your prison stay.
And it's actually unclear where he worked from 1979 when he left the Auburn Police Department to the early 1990s when he joined Save Mart. So they don't even know what he's been up to for all those years. He's
probably not
been
talking too
much. Well, he probably went into serious hiding, or maybe he went off and did some shit somewhere else and came back.
Yeah, well, you know, they think, I've talked about it before, but like they think that, what's his name? H.H. Holmes. I was thinking James Holmes all of a sudden. H.H. Holmes, they think he went across, you know,
the pond and Jack went over. Ripper. Right.
Yeah. Did murders over there.
Right.
It's definitely possible that he, and absolutely. I was thinking that because like people don't just stop doing this. They don't just be like, I'm retired being.
No, you don't cut this cold turkey. Life. Are you kidding me?
Yeah. Like, come on. Like he probably slowed it down because he was older, getting older.
And didn't want to get caught. So you have to play it safe. So
he probably went somewhere else and did stuff. I bet he left the state.
I bet he did too. I bet he fucking left for a while, and he's probably some other serial killer out there known as something else. Yeah,
he totally could be. Totally.
Because, like, think about it, especially back then in the 70s and 80s, it's a lot easier to, you know, elude the police. So he probably.
And he did it once. He moved areas once, knowing that that would be a good idea.
And at
he
that time, no social media, no internet. So you could elude the police a lot easier just moving to another city.
Yep.
Totally. Being a new city, no one knows you, no one knows where you're from.
Yeah.
And disappear, do some shit there, then go back, like, years later.
Yeah.
Maybe. I mean,
crazy.
That's crazy though. Yeah. God. Yeah. And he never was, no one ever suspected it. He was just, you know, no one expected that these crimes could have even been connected to him. They had no idea. He played it really cool.
There's really cool. A lot cool. of people out there like that, dude. Do you know there's a statistic that like everyone has met a killer at one point in their life? You've talked to someone who's killed someone?
Yeah, I have seen that before. That's crazy, man. God.
And it could, I think it could be like someone in the military though, too. I don't know. Like, is it all murderers?
Well, I think if you're getting away as a serial killer, I think you got to have some skills. You got to have some special skills.
Yeah.
I don't think the average person can do it, but so yeah, he was arrested this week and he actually was arraigned in court on Friday and he's being charged with a lot.
Fucking everything.
And I mean, again, we have to disclaimer, you know, suspect is innocent until proven guilty in the court of law. I mean, that's the way the system works though. Even though we don't know for sure that this
good,
is him.
It's good that it's like that, honestly.
But he is the prime suspect right now. All he did it. Signs point
he fucking
to,
did it.
Point to Joseph D'Angelo. And apparently he was brought into, he did not plea to the murder charges. And he has a public defender, actually. He's like broke. Like when they found him, guys, he was like literally just had no idea. Like he was, when he got arrested, he came out cool. He was like, hey, I got a roast in the oven. I need to like take care of the roast. Like cops were like, yeah, dude, we'll take care. Like, do you know what's even happening right now? He seemed very like, just kind of like depressed.
Maybe he knew it was always going to happen like, though. He was probably just waiting.
My life's coming to an end kind of
feeling,
you know.
Waiting for this day. Like in her book, at the end of her book, she was like, one day there will be a car pulling up and arresting you.
Yeah, yeah.
That will happen.
But as of right now, they only have charged him for the Katie and Brian Majory deaths in 1978 right now. They've only tied those two to him for sure. It'll take a while to get the rest. But apparently he's 72 years old. He looks like a withered down old man.
Yeah, he does.
He doesn't. I mean, he does look kind of like a sketchy dude, but he looks worn out at this point. And he was wheeled into the courtroom, Sacramento County courtroom today. And was represented by a public defender, and he appeared depressed, or as a lawyer said, that he's depressed right now and fragile.
Oh, poor you.
And he only spoke a few words at his hearing, apparently telling the judge very slowly in a feeble voice that he would accept a court-appointed attorney. Probably because he's like, I know I'm fucked. Like, I'm going to die anyway soon, so. Oh,
this is going to be an interesting trial to watch.
Howard told reporters that she feels like her client has received unfair press. Well, yeah, everybody's, of course, going to jump to the conclusion that he's the, because he fucking is. I mean, it really seems like he is. It seems like there's plenty of evidence to suggest that Joseph D'Angelo is the Golden State Killer. And so, yeah.
Sorry.
His next hearing is scheduled for May 14th, 2018 at 8:30 a.m. So we can all follow this. We'll definitely give you updates on this because this is interesting. I don't know, man. This is pretty big though. In California, I bet they will.
Casey Anthony.
I bet they will in California. I don't know if they'll do it like nationally or anything, but it'll be in
California.
There'll
probably be clips at least on the news though afterwards.
But this is huge. Like think about like all the people who've lived in fear and all the victims who've just been tormented by this. Like just hearing that woman talk about her experience, there is at least 50 more of those that happened. That's a lot of terror and pain and just suffering that
God, what a year for this to happen. This has been the year of Me Too. It really has. Like 2018 is like the year of the woman.
Time to fucking shut this shit down.
Time's up. You're done.
Shut this.
You're not going to get away with that bullshit.
Violence down.
I think it's awesome he was caught this year. I mean, I wish it was sooner, obviously, but yeah. I wish Michelle could have seen it. It's really sad. Because I like understand that kind of like obsession and passion with cases because I like, I'm like that too. So I just like, she probably really would have wanted to know. I would have been so bummed out if I died before like finding out something that I've been looking for my whole life.
Oh, that would suck.
And it's so hard for Patton, I'm sure, to like know, like, imagine that was me and you knew how important it would have been to me.
Tears them apart. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, I think it's been really hard this week for him. It's been like really bittersweet because on one hand, he's like been into it too. So he's happy that the guy's caught. But it's like, I wish my wife could have seen this. And she wasn't that far off from being able to see it. It's crazy.
It is crazy. And I mean, I think he deserves whatever sentence he gets.
Victim in a way.
And honestly, it's kind of, it's sucks for all the victims that he got to live all these years, a normal life.
It's like Bill Cosby. He'll
literally
end up, you know, dying
live
in
a
jail.
Great life, really, for what he did. And you know, now he's an old man and he's going to die anyway soon. And now he gets, you know, he gets to like sit in prison probably for a few years, but he'll be gone and out and done. But you know what? You just have to hope that in these types of situations that there is something more to all of this and that he does, you know, have an opportunity to redeem himself and redeem his soul and all the others as well.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think things go on from there, but I hope justice is served for the victim's sake. And I mean,
it just sucks though, because justice will never be served.
No,
unless they like,
no, absolutely not,
publicly get to kill this guy.
But even then, it's like, then what? You just like,
yeah, it's still like,
doesn't bring back over your loved ones. You know, it doesn't bring back those people.
No, there's no way that they could ever inflict the pain that he caused them onto him.
Absolutely not.
Especially at this age. I mean, what does he have to lose?
Nothing.
Can't take anything from him. Can't take his life. It's not like he is like raising two young kids. He's old.
Yeah.
He basically got away with everything.
Literally. Yeah, he literally got away with
everything.
And then
he'll probably die in jail, like Ariel Castro.
Yeah, he might as well be dead right now. I mean, it's... So yeah, stupid. I guess it'll be interesting to see what happens with this. I mean, I think we already know what's going to happen, but...
It is good for the family's sake, though. Like, all of the people whose parent died, or sister, brother, coworkers, friends, like, it's probably nice for them to at least know the dude's off the streets. That's never going to happen again, at least from him. So
at least people in these areas that he attacked can sleep a bit safer.
Right.
And sleep, you know, don't have to sleep with one eye open anymore.
Yeah, I mean, like, God, there were so many.
Because like during that rampage, dude, people like, there was like thousands of guns that were bought. Oh, locks. Yeah. And
I would have bought everybody a gun if was I lived in that area.
Paranoid. Everybody was absolutely, he inflicted a lot of terror, basically a terrorist on this community, on these multiple communities. And that is a lot of fucking suffering and pain that they had to go through. And, you know, he kind of gets to take the easy way out now. So I guess life's not fair, but damn, what an interesting case though. I actually find serial killers very fascinating, and I do like covering these. I think they're interesting.
It's hard though. I find myself like, I enjoy learning about it, but it is hard to do the research. Like, I've had some times where I'm like, damn, this is getting really rough to like just report, just like take notes on murder after murder after murder. It's definitely like the hardest outline for me to do is serial killer stuff.
But yeah.
You did a good job with this. This is very interesting.
No, I think I covered, I mean, I probably didn't cover everything. There's a lot to it. I mean, there's tons of experiences. There's tons of interviews. There's a lot, and more stuff is going to be coming out on this, but at least this helps you give you a pretty good idea of who the Golden State Killer is, and what he did, and you know, the victims that were affected and what they went through.
So you can follow the whole trial and the whole
absolutely
process. I know a lot of people want to like follow absolutely things, but
so
super interesting case though, that's for sure.
Yes, great episode. Thank you guys for joining us today. It was a fantastic time with y'all. Hopefully you enjoyed it. If you did, be sure to leave us a review and rating on iTunes if you wouldn't mind. That would be awesome.
Yes.
But hopefully we can get episode 15 back up for you guys here soon. And
yes,
we will see you guys next week.
Stay woke,
everybody.